Suggestions can make cheap wine taste top shelf, warp our perception of time, and alter our memories. We're looking at the power of suggestion and how it changes the brain and shapes our behavior.
Dr. Amir Raz is a neuroscientist who is sharing decades of research in his new book. It is called The Suggestible Brain, The Science and Magic of How We Make Up Our Minds. And Dr. Raz joins us now. Good morning.
Good morning.
So in this book, you write about the difference between suggestion and suggestibility. What is the difference there?
Suggestibility is basically how every individual responds to a specific suggestion, whereas suggestion is our intuitive notion of some kind of a communication that gets us to do something, sometimes even without our awareness. Hmm.
Is for suggesting, is it a matter of you suggest it once? Is it over and over and over again? How practical is just making a mere suggestion? How much consistency is required to actually make it work?
Right. So suggestions comes in all kinds of flavors. I mean, we get suggestions from our doctors. We get suggestions from our neighbors, from our parents, from our spouses. We get all kinds of suggestions. Sometimes they repeat, sometimes they don't. The most important thing about suggestions is that they're very powerful. And if you know how to use suggestions in line with culture, in line with expectations, in line with what makes a particular person tick, you can get some very dramatic outcomes on behavior and on decision making.
And in regards to depression and anxiety, you also write about how suggestions can help people in this regard.
Absolutely. I mean, we live in a world where many of us are engaged in some way with mental health, either directly or through family members. And there's a whole world in psychiatry and in mental health that is largely untapped that has to do with the power of suggestion, the power of hope, and the ability to communicate with people beyond medications, particularly when we know that some medications are not very effective, or at least not as effective as we would like for them to be.
That's kind of what I was going to ask next regarding kind of placebo pills can almost be seen as a suggestion. Why do people kind of believe in those even if they know it doesn't work? Is it just a matter of convincing themselves and making that suggestion to themselves?
Yeah, so these are very deep questions. You know, would a placebo work if I know that I'm getting a placebo? Now, the answer in a short form is yes. And people have done these kind of studies. The studies are not perfect and they're early days, but it's very interesting to see that even when you do studies, for example, for lower back pain, for migraines and other things, and you give people a placebo in an open label fashion, so you say to them, this is a placebo, but I think it's going to help you, we see improvement in the clinical outcomes that these individuals are experiencing. Mm.
And you also write about gaslighting and mental abuse in some cases there. How are people likely to weaponize suggestion in this case?
Suggestion, just like anything else, suggestions can be used for good and for bad. In the wrong hands and by individuals who are using them nefariously, you can use suggestions to make our lives worse and to have people suffer particular distortions in their memory, in their self-esteem, and so on. But by and large, suggestion, the science of suggestion, teaches us a great deal about how we can use and leverage suggestion to our benefit and to increase our ability to deal and navigate the world.
You said that suggestibility tests are more reliable than IQ tests. Kind of describe what a suggestibility test is and why it's more reliable.
So in psychology, we usually have reliability criteria in order to determine how effective something is, and also the test-retest reliability of something. In other words, how does it translate into real life? When we take an IQ test, we usually would like for our score to be as high as possible because we would like to think that we're very intelligent, or we'd like to be as intelligent as we can be. When we take a suggestibility test, most people don't want to score very high because they think that suggestibility is akin to or similar to a form of feeble-mindedness or being weak or spineless or having, you know, being under the influence of somebody else. But in terms of their scientific value, suggestibility tests are more reliable, more powerful in terms of their ability to predict things than IQ tests, for example.
Mm. Well, it's a really fascinating topic here. Again, the book is called The Suggestible Brain, The Science and Magic of How We Make Up Our Minds. Dr. Raz, we really appreciate your time. There's your information. Thanks so much and happy Thanksgiving.
Thank you.
Pleasure. Same to you guys.